holes, whose coherence, whose systematicity is not explained, it's just taken for granted. The typical totality is the word society as a whole. Now, why does this happen? Well, because society as a whole, you know, typical people do that kind of thing when they're talking about holism. Holism has many different meanings. Meaning in California, having to do with some kind of weird medical treatments. But it is similar. It's like take the whole for granted. Society as a whole, capitalism as another totality, at least in the way in which the word was used by Marx. And again, that is the standard use of using the word, it's the capitalist system. The entire thing forms a system. And what we need to do replace them with assemblages. This is why I wanted you to read that first chapter. Assemblages are wholes, but wholes whose systematicity, whose properties are properly explained. Assemblages have what is called emergent properties. Also sometimes referred to as synergistic properties. Well, Mr. Fuller, who has a couple of books called Synergy, or Synergetics, I can't remember right now, he was one of the main advocates of the concept of an emergent property. But Mr. Fuller, like many others in the past, used metallic alloys as an example. We can use that to think of bronze, which is of course a combination of copper and tin in the proper proportions. Can't remember right now the proportions, 9:1 or 8:2 or something like that. Very specific proportions. Now when you take a small block of copper and put it in a special apparatus that's going to measure its tensile strength by pulling, so you have your apparatus, you pull more, and then it breaks. And you check your dial, and it says, I don't know, it's capable of withstanding 6 pounds per square inch. I'm totally making this up. And then you take tin, and you measure its tensile strength. Let's say that it is 2 pounds per square inch. So that's 6 plus 2, 8. So you say bronze is just a combination of tin and copper. One has 6 pounds per square inch, the other one has a tensile strength of 2 pounds per square inch. Well, bronze should have 8 pounds per square inch. And when you actually measure bronze, it has more than 8 pounds per square inch, like 9 or 10. Where does that extra strength? This is why Mr. Fuller defined emergent properties as properties of a whole that are more than the sum of its parts. That's not the best definition, but if we can start with that. Particular case, the sum of its parts would be the sum of the tensile strength of tin, the sum of the tensile strength of copper, and then that should be the tensile strength of bronze, but bronze has more than the sum. Where does that extra come from? Well, when you take a microscope and look inside bronze, you see that the copper and the tin have developed fractal fingers, and the fractal fingers have interlocked within the material, and that structure, and you guys must know about this because you interlock beams and columns into an iron frame. Well, and what Mr. Fuller did too for his geodesic, his spherical structures, is that interlock that's going to give you the extra strength. There's strength in the structure, in this case, the microstructure of the material. Nevertheless, a better definition of emergent properties is this. This is a current definition. The property of a whole that arises or is produced by the interaction between its parts. By the interactions between its parts. In the case of metals, the interactions are just mechanical, interlocking fractal fingers. But when you begin to apply it to ecosystems, or you begin to apply it to communities, or you begin to apply it to organizations, they will have different types of emergent properties. The most important thing about emergent properties is that they block reductionism. Molecules cannot be reduced to atoms. Cells cannot be reduced to molecules. Organs cannot be reduced to cells. Organisms cannot be reduced to organs. Ecosystems cannot be reduced to organisms. Planets cannot be reduced to organisms, to ecosystems, and so on and so forth. Why? Because at every level, there are new properties that emerge from the interactions between the parts. Think again, very microscopically. Hydrogen and oxygen. If you have a fire and you throw oxygen at it, you excite the fire because oxygen is a fuel. If you have a fire and you throw hydrogen into it, you're also going to excite that fire because hydrogen is a fuel. But once hydrogen and oxygen begin interacting with each other and form an assemblage, the molecule of water, which is two atoms of hydrogen for every one of oxygen, they form something that has new properties. You throw water to the fire, and it's not going to excite it, it's going to extinguish it. Water has properties that neither oxygen nor hydrogen have. And what is true at the level of chemistry is true at the level of biology. Cells cannot be reduced to their genes. Organs cannot be reduced to their cells, and so on and so forth. It is very, very important in this class that we block reductionism. Because even in social science, even when you are not goofy enough to say, like many physicists say, well, all we are is a cloud of atoms. Really? Just a cloud of atoms, huh? It's like every scientific specialty, they want to reduce things to their level, you know, so that they become like the masters of the universe. So if your level is the level of atoms, everything is atoms. If your level is subatomic particles, well, everything is subatomic particles. If you're a geneticist, well, everything is genes. If you're a neurophysiologist, well, everything is just neurons. Well, no, people. Or if you're an economist, you try to reduce everything to individual persons. Every person's decisions to buy or to sell, and then everything else doesn't really exist. Margaret Thatcher is very famous for having said, there is no such thing as society, there's only people and their families. Really? Reductionism is bad, and it's bad because it is wrong, it is untrue. And it's untrue because things at a material level or at a social level have emergent properties. So what we need to do here is to replace every entity that exists out there, that talks about the system as a whole, and replace it with specific assemblages. I'm going to discuss this in a lot more detail tomorrow, but let me give you a sense of what we're going to be talking about tomorrow. I'm going to give you a much more complex diagram tomorrow. I'm going to deliberately simplify it right now, just to give you a sense of what we're going to be talking about, okay?